Kylie.
All right, what's up, Dime? Can you guys hear me? Yeah, all right.
Come on, I know we had some calm music playing, but we have a heavy-hitting special guest here for our masterclass today. I'd like to invite everybody to come and sit up as close to the stage as we can get. Let's fill these seats in and make this nice and personal, because we got one of the nicest people I've ever worked with, as well as one of the widest-ranging resumes going to be sitting up here on the stage, Mr. Paul Reiser. So who here in the room, just before we get rolling, raise your hands if you are a songwriter. Don't have to be in the songwriting program, but if you write your own songs, yeah? Awesome. Beautiful. Raise your hand if you arrange for other people's songs. So that, there we go. Nice. All right, raise your hand if you want to work in a recording studio as a sideman or as a band leader. Beautiful. How about as a producer? Yeah, there we go. Okay. How about as a freelance business person? Everybody in this room should be raising their hand. That's a spoiler right there. So the gentleman who we're going to bring up has done all of these things and more for a career that spans many decades, eras of music, labels, artists that you would not believe. I have a bit of a video I want to show you first before we get rolling, before we bring him out. That's a bit of a some songs you guys might know. This goes from Motown and beyond. So just check this little little teaser out here. All these arrangements you're hearing, all of them. So please give a warm round of applause and welcome Mr. Paul Reiser to the stage.
Hello, everybody. Hello. Glad you could be here. Yes. What a pleasure it is for me. And hopefully we can put on a good show for you here.
Yeah. Can we get a little bit more on Paul's mic? Anybody running the board? Can we get... Thanks, Aaron. Awesome. Cool. So I want to start... We decided not to do this in a chronological order of Mr. Reiser's career because there's so much there. We could do 3 masterclasses, 4 masterclasses, and still not cover it. So I wanted to focus this entire thing on skill sets and how they've applied throughout the course of Paul's long and winding and continuing career. And so here's what I want to do real quick. I'm just going to do an exercise with the crowd. I want you guys to raise your hand. I'm going to list some artists. Keep your hand up as soon as you hear one that you know, okay? How about The Temptations? Awesome. Keep those hands up. Mm-hmm. How about Joss Stone? Yep, keep them up. Keep them up, even if you've heard of any one of them. Yep. Stevie Wonder. All right. All of our hands should be up by now. The Jackson 5, Michael Jackson. All right, there we go. Cool. So these are just some of the people who Paul has worked with throughout the years. And what I wanted to start with is Paul's just a nice guy.
Well, thank
you. And one of the things that I am always inspired by is we hear about stories of bands breaking up. We hear about artists having bad blood and controversy and blah, blah, blah. But Mr. Reiser is getting calls to work with people who he's been working with since he was...
How about 17?
17, okay. And so I wanted to talk, I wanted to talk about networking, professionalism, and keeping on good terms with people in the industry first and foremost.
Yeah. Well, you know, first of all, you got to have something inside. This is true, because people pick that up in music. Producers, writers, executives, record execs, they pick those things up. So... I've tried to be true to the music, true to the game, so to speak, all these years, and managed to do it. You know, music will separate the good music, I should say, will separate the true people from the untrue. You know, it keeps you honest. Good music does. So I've been blessed. You know. Yeah.
Can you tell them a little bit about your early connections with people like Dale Warren, George Bohannon?
Oh, yes.
And how you got to know those people and what doors they opened for you?
Well, first of all, I was a cast tech, okay? Classical trained and jazz and classical, no, nothing but. But, you know, I hated R&B. Honest to God, I did. I hated R&B, okay? But I got a call from a friend, Dale Warren, who preceded me in graduation from Cass by about a year. He went to Motown before I did. They needed a trombone player, all right, for a session. So Dale thought about me. And I was 17 at that time, into my last year, my senior year at Cass. And I sat down next to the great George Bohannon. Who knows the name in here? George Bohannon, trombone. One of the greatest, yeah. So I sat down in that, I call it the hot seat. You know, anytime you play in a session, it's like being in a hot seat, really. Because you come in and you have to be good sight readers. You have to have good stamina. And I gained a quick respect for R&B music, all right, once I sat down in the hot seat. Because the producers will say, take 10. Before you know it, you're up to take 15, take 20. And the lips are hanging down to your shoe tops, you know, the chops, right? Me being a trombone player. So it was a lot of wind, a lot of stamina. But I gained a very, very, I guess you could say, a really rich a love and a understanding of R&B music and a respect, you know, because I watched how the parts, all the parts had to come together. And in order to, it's like a chemical, you know, and the chemistry, I guess you could say a chemical mixture that has to come together to make things happen. That's what good music does. See, it's like chemistry happening together. Your perfect chemistry.
It sounds like we're starting to touch already on the concept of open-mindedness and versatility towards different styles of music. Is there anybody in this room who is not a particular fan of country music? I was one of them for a long time. It's okay. Honesty is okay here. Yeah, right. So the Survivor's saying he wasn't a huge fan of R&B music at the time, right? And Motown Records is known for the R&B heroes, legends who broke barriers and introduced African-American culture to the mainstream, really. But they also had country artists. They had R.D.
Yes,
and Taylor.
They
had hits, country hits on Motown. They had rock and roll hits on Motown with Rare Earth. They
had
jazz albums, spoken word albums. So can you tell us, what was your first experience as far as getting a chart and saying, I don't like this? What was that like for you?
Well, ran into quite a few of those, actually. Okay. But you know, it's a challenge every time you get a song to do. It's a challenge to make it better. If you can't make it better, leave it alone. That's my whole credo as far as doing arrangements. But of course, at Motown was like a factory, literally. You know, we would get songs in, the arrangers would get them, and they would be half-baked, so to speak. You know, we had to just a lot of times make something out of nothing. And I respect the Funk Brothers for giving it that kind of a push, too. Without the Funk Brothers, Motown sound would not be. You know, those were a tremendous bunch of guys.
And the Funk Brothers, for those who may not know, are the band. It was a mostly stable crew of musicians playing on all of these songs by all of these artists. It was the recording
rhythm
band.
Section.
And so the Funk Brothers are a great example of what we're talking about as far as this networking and professionality, because Paul started working in Motown when he was 17 with the Funk Brothers, and the last recording by three of the original Funk Brothers together with Eddie Willis on guitar, Bob Babbitt on bass, and Uriel Jones on drums.
That's right.
We're talking about almost 50 years after the fact. Who arranged the strings for that recording? Paul Reiser. So can you tell us, how have you managed to stay on such good terms and stay connected with your coworkers throughout the years? Any advice on keeping those connections rolling?
Yeah, it's good productions are about good relationships. If you don't have good relationships with your producers and sometimes your writers, particularly your producers and your the label or the production company, and you have to have good material, good songs, be blessed with good songs to do, because without that, nothing from nothing leaves nothing. Somebody wrote a song like that too, Billy Preston Rand. But you know, you have to have a decent song, a song with good structure to it. Things you don't have to just redo and turn all the way around to make a song out of it. A good friend of mine, actually a couple of good friends in the audience, McKinley Jackson and Piranha Head. Are both here. I think they can attest to that. You know, McKinley Jackson worked around Holland Dozier Holland, the greatest writing team probably in the history of pop music. See, Holland Dozier Holland. So it takes a good song, good structure, and sometimes we have to make adjustments to make it all work. But usually a producer will come to you with a song that's pretty much in intact, you know, where we don't have to do a whole lot to it as far as structure. We just have to get the chordal progressions and the harmonics together and make it work for the musicians, see? Yes.
Well, in that case, let's dive into some of the nitty-gritty music talk for a minute. So I'm fortunate to have here some session files from some of the original Motown recordings. You guys will probably know this tune. And this is a song that Paul arranged the rhythm section for, as well as the sweetenings, the strings, and all the kind of beautiful elements on top. But from what I understand, you just got the demo in the first place. So I'm going to play just a little bit of just the vocals, so we can get a sense of what song we're talking about here before we dive into it.
Listen, baby, ain't no mountain high, ain't no valley low, ain't no river wide enough, baby.
Anybody know that song? Raise your hand if you know that tune.
Everybody knows.
There we go. All right. So before we dive into the arrangement of this song, I want to ask, what was the demo like when they brought this to you in the studio? What was already there?
Well, of course, it's just a piano and vocal demo. Nick Ashford and Valerie Simpson, great writers, great interpreters of choral structures. Valerie Simpson on the keyboard, mm-hmm. right to this minute, she's great, you know. And when they brought it to me, didn't have to adjust much chordally or rhythmically either. You know, it's just a matter of understanding what they wanted. You know, because they bring it to me, they expect me to expand what they've got. See, so I have to think of the Funk Brothers and what parts they're gonna play and. And then we go in and we get it done. Yeah.
And but oftentimes the Funk Brothers would have one of the greatest bass players ever to That's walk right. the earth, Mr. James Jamerson, playing bass.
Right.
But they would have acoustic piano and electric piano or organ all together. Mm-hmm. They would have hand percussion, most of the time congas and tambourine, as well as two separate drummers. And as many as three or four guitar players all at once.
Right.
So from a rhythm section arrangement perspective, how do you arrange for that type of ensemble? That's such a large
Well, first you have to understand the characteristics that each has as an individual, what their style is, and then you just write accordingly, you know? There are certain, one guitar player might not be able to give you what you need as far as what you have in the arrangement. So you just find that part for, take Dennis Coffey. Excellent guitarist. You know, Joe Messina, Eddie Willis. Eddie was not a great reader, but he had a feel, great feel. Robert White guitar was a great reader, but he didn't have a great feel, okay? Dennis Coffey did it all. He was a man of all jack of all trades, okay? He could do it all, trust me. Joe Messina was always steady as a rock, you know, great reader, interpreter of parts that you have written down. But you have to know your people, in other words, just to finalize that thought. You have to really know the individuals, their personalities, their abilities on the instrument, and then you work accordingly. You sign parts.
I got another song here real quick just to demonstrate what he's talking about as far as teamwork in the studio. Just check out these guitar parts here. Let me see if I'm in the right spot of the song. Just there. Mm-hmm. How many guitar parts can you guys pick out? Three? I hear four. I hear someone strumming chords.
Yeah.
I hear someone doing the backbeats, beats two and four on these high shanks. Yep. And then I hear one person sliding into a chord and holding it out while a fourth guitar player is just playing over and over again. That's it. Here it is. And then call and response here, too, between the guitars.
Yes. See,
yeah.
Those are all unique.
You can applaud that.
Yeah.
So give us a sense of the teamwork in the studio.
Okay.
What has to happen here to make this work?
Eddie Willis. We call him Chank. That was his nickname, Chank, right? Robert White was kind of the steady. Chidang, as he was doing something like Chidang, Chidang, and I think it was, no, I take that back. Robert White was doing the little single note parts in there. Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, that was Robert White. And Joe Messina was always laying there doing the, like, just filling up the middle, strumming pretty much. And Eddie Willis, he was like the chank, that every time you hear that sharp upbeat, you know, up, that's how he did it. Chank, you know, not, as opposed to down, he was upbeat, you know, upstroke.
Let's go back to Ain't No Mountain for a second here, because if anybody can see the screen here, we have two separate pieces of drums. So I'm just going to play one little bit of some of the drums here for you guys to check out what's happening. Second drum part right here.
Yeah.
So, anybody who knows this song, that little drum click pattern, that da 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 da.
Rim track.
Tell them from an arrangement standpoint, tell them what motif means.
Okay, it's a motif means is it like a style. It's a style pattern. Okay, that's a motif. That ticka ticka ticka. That's a motif, and it stands out. And it's a distinct, identifying part. You know, motif, and it just it repeats itself. You see.
And so, same thing. We're talking about not having an ego in the studio. We're talking about working together as a team. Can you imagine having an entire drum set in front of you? Yeah. One person's over there going poom god poom poom god poom poom, and you have to just go da 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 da.
Right, 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 right.
Right. An egotistical drummer is going to say, "No, I'm good."
That's right.
Yeah, yeah.
But see, that one little part, that rim part, is precise. It's got to be precise. If it's off the hair, it doesn't work. See.
All right, I'm going to do one more playback. Then I want to open this up for a couple questions, because we have not yet talked about bass, but listen real quick to this bass part. This is from a Four Tops song called Bernadette, before we jump back into the other song. This is James Jamerson Jr., right? James Jamerson Sr.
Yes.
How do you tell
that's
that
so
guy
unique.
What to do?
You know?
Yeah. So let me see. I'm going to let that roll just a little bit longer. I just wanted to keep time there so you guys could understand how much space this one instrument is filling up in the rhythmic arrangement.
Yes.
Right?
Perfect bass player, you know. It's perfect.
So tell us a little bit about, was there ever any push and pull between arranging a part for a player who's so virtuosic, whose choices are so unique?
Oh, yes. You take a guy temperamental as James Jamerson, oh yeah. First of all, he knew how good he was. Secondly, he'd take a sip of sauce before he comes to a session. So you know you got a fight on your hand. But he was very cooperative. As long as he knew that you challenged him, you got to challenge him, see. But that particular song there, he's such a melodic player. He used to be a cello player originally. Okay, that's why he hears all these melodies and all these movements, all with one finger, by the way, one finger, as opposed to multiple picks, you know. And he's just such a melodic bass player, you know. It's like a melody within the the actual melody of the song. He listens to what the vocal is doing, what the other instruments are doing, like nobody else, you know. And he makes his part fit. Yeah.
But at the same time, he could go back and do something as simple as this. I'm just going to backtrack for 1 second. Talk about one of the most simple but iconic bass parts ever.
Yeah. Everybody recognizes that, huh?
Do I need to keep that going for anybody? Cool.
That's Robert White, guitar. That's what he was known for. Yeah.
And just walking up the pentatonic scale.
Dum, 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 dum. Very simple. Five, six, eight. You know.
Learn your scales, guitar players.
Yes, yes, yes.
So was that part written?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Cool. Mm-hmm. So again, teamwork. We're still talking about a guy who he knows he's good. He knows he can play that shredding bass line that you heard on Bernadette.
Yeah.
But when it comes time to play the team part, he's not afraid to step back.
That's right.
I'd like to open the floor for any questions you guys have about just working with different personalities, teamwork, and kind of the social dynamic of this before we get into more nitty-gritty musical arranging. So let's take a couple questions. And give us your name first as well, and then the question. So, yeah. Sure.
Mm-hmm. Hi, my name is Frederick.
Now, where are you?
Right here.
Right here.
Let me see. Mm-hmm. Right here. I wanted to know, which artist did you enjoy working with the most in Motown?
That's the easy one.
Okay.
How about Stevie Wonder?
Okay. 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 Why did you enjoy working with him so much?
Always a challenge.
Okay.
I called him the brain buster, see, because he knew what he wanted all the time, you know. Yet he didn't dictate parts to me. He always trusted my judgment. I don't know why, but he did. So we work as a great team, even to this day. We do. Great team. He never just dictates or gets worried about what's coming.
That's good.
Mm-hmm. Excellent songwriter, you know.
From a professionalism standpoint, without naming names, so don't tell us the name, but any stories of artists who you did not like working with and why, that way we can take some notes. Don't tell us who, though. I'm not asking who.
Well, McKinley Jackson can attest to this. I want to call a name. But, let me just describe. Worst demos in the world, okay? Worst demos.
Drew Schultz, not kidding.
Yeah. But thought they were just God's greatest gift to production, you know, this particular person. Good spirit, good attitude and everything. Worst demos in the world, okay? Right. Literally. Right. So we had to patch him up and sew him up like an injured person on the battlefield, you know? I tell you, we had to work. Is it not right, Mac? We know what we're talking about.
we have one more question at the table back here. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Hi, my name is Marissa. When you're working with a lot of people to put together a song and you all hit a block at a certain point, how do you move past that?
Now, you say a block like a creative block?
Like a writer's block.
Writer's block, yeah. Mm-hmm. It happens, but you know what you have to do instead of plotting ahead. You know, of course, there are deadlines to most every project, but instead of plotting ahead, you have to back off sometimes, you know? And now, me myself, I write better at the last minute, okay? Okay.
Don't take
like
those
I call
notes.
It hot off the press. But yes, that writer's block, it happens to everybody. Okay? But you don't keep plowing ahead because you're not going to be satisfied with what you get. You know, I would rather run a little bit off the schedule, but get what I want. You know, because you're getting it for posterity, and you gotta, it's there for good. You know, it's not like you hear it in the marketplace and then you say, God, I wish I had I had another chance at that. Or I did it wrong, and I wish I had done this. Because a lot of producers, they take a chance when they put the music in the arranger's hands, because first of all, they mean well, but they don't always know what they want. They want to appear that they know what they want, but they don't always know. See, it's a guessing game. So when they put it in our hands, the arranger's hands, it's really taking a chance, okay? Because they don't know whether we're gonna come in and have a mental glitch or whatever the next day with their song. So they take a chance. They really do. Sometimes they have to recut some things over, and hopefully it's not too expensive. But it's if it's necessary to go back in and redo something to get what's necessary, because it's for posterity, like I said, history. It's just worth it sometimes. There's no such thing as a perfect song or arrangement or production. No such animal, you know. I don't care how good it sounds on the radio. It's work, okay? Yeah.
We'll take some more questions in a minute. Let's dive back into this session real quick. So we're just going to listen to this track at a time, layer it on. Before we start listening to the string part, we'll listen to that last, because mm-hmm. that'll open the door to a whole nother can of worms. So yeah. Here's our piano and the Glockenspiel bell part. Sounds like they got some kick drum in there, too. Bass into this. So these parts, except for the bass part, are all moving in unison, right? So they're all moving in unison,
yes.
Except for the bass.
Right.
Yep.
Right.
Now here's our guitar part. Just there. That's three.
Strong.
And then holding chords, yep. Yep. One drum part. Second drum part. Already really full before we ever add strings. So mm-hmm. let's listen for a moment to the string part here, because we're talking about versatility. Mr. Reiser entered as a trombone player playing sessions, arranging rhythm, moving to arranging horns and strings, and then I would say that I can't speak for you, but so much of what you've done has been string arranging. So let's listen to the string part real quick. I want to see how it fits into the puzzle. Let's listen to it by itself once, though.
Mm-hmm. Harp.
Lots of space there, too. Comes. are right there, mm-hmm. almost like we're talking about the guitar parts, the teamwork yeah. of the guitar parts. I hear two separate motif pieces in the strings, right? I hear a lower piece and a higher piece, kind of playing. Here we go.
Oh, that's you hear that? That's a harmonic, yeah.
Yep, yep. Mm-hmm. So there's like a counterpoint, right? Mm-hmm. So
yes.
In arranging, tell, explain a little bit about what counterpoint is from an
okay,
arranging standpoint for us.
Point. I guess you have a certain basic. I guess you could call it foundation that you're dealing with. And it's like an established thing in the song, but then you say, well, I might want to do something counter to that. That's what they call it, counterpoint. And that's why I use, and music is like a conversation, okay? That's why the instruments should talk to one another, you know, the parts.
Yeah.
And that's the way I hear music, you know? It should work within the voices, not against the voices, but or overpower the voices or the other instruments. Because everything in there is important. You have to just find its place in your imagination and use it.
So we have a foundation here that mm-hmm. ba-ba-ba-da-da-da.
Right.
I'm not a singer. And then there's a higher melody.
Violas and violas doing it.
Is it violins playing the higher melody on top
yes.
of it?
Yes.
There's a counterpoint right there.
Right.
And that higher melody comes back.
Yes. But only a solid on the string this time, as opposed to harmonic, you know. Yeah.
So remember how we said that the motif of the drums, da-da-da-da-da,
yes.
right?
Right?
It happens every couple bars. Here's mm-hmm. a motif that comes around a whole second time later in the song.
Yeah.
Yep, yep. Yeah. Any questions about this side of arranging while we're getting into it? Motifs, melodic writing? Yes, mm-hmm. yes.
And you see the bigness of the sound. You can never get that with synthesizer. See, because with synthesizer, you know, it's so pure. The pitch is there. If you don't detune, say you could do three or four tracks, but if you don't detune just a hair, it's going to sound just like if you're trying to get the sound of 10, you're going to still sound like one or two, you know, because they're all playing the same pitch. Whereas with live players, you know, there's just a lot of imperfections, and that's where you get the big sound.
It's like auto-tuned vocals versus the real thing. Same idea. Mm-hmm. Yes, we had a question. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Hi, my name is Peyton Williams. So when you're arranging strings or horns, do you listen to the song as a whole or do you focus on the bass melody?
the vocal melody?
That's a good question. I listen to it as a whole. You know, the parts just have to work. They have to work independent of one another. That's why an arrangement should basically stand alone without vocals. It should have melody within the melody, okay? That's why certain tracks are so distinguished or distinctive because of the way they're arranged, see? You automatically hear that without the vocal and you know what song it is, you see? Because of certain other parts weaving in and out. It's so complicated a song. It's really hard to say. Every song is different. Every song is like a fingerprint. Number one, okay. No two are alike. And just have to hope you have imagination to keep coming year after year after year, you know, because you only have 12 notes to work with. See? Okay. Different registers, different textures, and yeah, but it's only 12 notes, so it's a miracle that it's just infinite combinations with those 12.
So, and the reason why this song specifically, yeah. I wanted to look at all the tracks is because this is one of the songs that Mr. Reiser arranged the rhythm section and the strings for, mm-hmm. and so he had a hand in all of it. So Peyton, to your question, there are songs mm-hmm. that came to him that were more complete before mm-hmm. you were adding just the string part.
Yeah.
Let's look at a song that I know is one of his favorites. This is written, produced by Marvin Gaye. And on one of Marvin Gaye's, not one of his groups, they were a Motown group that sang a lot of backgrounds for a lot of different artists, had hits of their own. One of the members wrote Please Mr. Postman, among others. But I know that this is one of your favorite arrangements. And so I want to listen to this as a total package, not like we've been checking out Ain't No Mountain, so we can hear the conversation that you're talking about. Yes. This is Baby I'm For Real by the Originals.
How much I love you, baby, and how much I want to be your only man. Oh, baby, 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 you don't have to go. Stay a little while longer, baby. I wanna talk to you just a little more. I see the little tears in your eyes about to fall. You are wondering if I'm boring.
I tell you, those parts, they sound so hard, you know, when you hear them out of the master phase, you know, oh, man, it's you hear all the little problems that happen, okay? You hear everything.
I'm fanning out over here. I'm like, that's amazing. Yeah. And so sometimes record labels will do different single mixes versus different album mixes. That what we just heard was the single mix. So it's what you would likely hear on the radio. And you guys can hear those strings are just as loud as the voices mixed in that record. Those strings are loud in that mix. So getting to what Peyton was asking about, arranging with the larger picture in mind, what was your thought process going into that particular song?
Well, first of all, I love ballads, you know. It's chord structure was good. The rhythm production was good. So I kind of had fun doing it, you know. And you have to think, like I said, conversation between the strings and the rhythm and the vocals. Let it breathe occasional, you know, but had fun doing it. Yes.
And there were some moments that I'm just asking as a fan now, guys. This is me geeking out here. Freddie Gorman had the lower voice in that group, and C.P. Spencer comes right behind him singing a full octave above him.
Yes.
Did anybody catch what bridges the gap between Freddie Gorman and C.P. Spencer?
Yeah.
The strings.
Yes.
Right? And so was that a conscious decision to run up that register almost to prepare the listener to hear the higher voice?
Yeah. Support.
To support. So, Peyton, does that answer your question about thinking about the larger picture and not just, oh, well, this melody is nice, or I can throw in this cool thing, but how it serves the bigger song. Mm-hmm. Any other questions? Yes. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Neil.
How are you? Great to meet you. I'm Nige.
Yes.
I'm a second-year songwriter. And my question, I have two. My first question is, so I was just thinking about this whole thing, and I do, like, my music, I make my music by myself. Like, I do all the lyrics, all the music, all the arranging, like, all the mixing and all of that, and I'm, like, working towards getting better at it. Diamond's helped me out a lot with that, and I was just wondering, like, what kind of advice first would you have for someone who does everything by themselves, just for me to, like, notate? And then my second question was, I'm aware that you mix musically, like you arrange musically, but like, have you ever arranged lyrically? That was my.
Rarely, you know. I would never present myself as a lyricist. No, I understand lyrics, you know, when I see good lyrics or hear good lyrics, I understand them. But I'm not a lyricist. That's an art in itself. Now, in respect to you doing all of the production and the creativity on your material, it's a rare thing to be able to do all that, number one, and do it well. It's a genius in that, like with Stevie Wonder, Valerie Simpson, Aretha, okay, that's able to really do that, do it well, and hear all the parts as they would be in the marketplace. Any class production, first class production, that's very rare in the industry. Prince was another one. R. Kelly, no, I take it back. He's good, but I take that back. He's talented, okay?
We'll cut that out of the digital feed. Yeah.
Great talent, you know. But seriously, though, he is not a. He hears parts, but he doesn't hear them like a Stevie Wonder.
How about Raphael Saadiq?
Valerie Simpson. Yeah.
Raphael.
Yes.
Saadiq. Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. Great one, Raphael.
These are all example. People who he's worked with, by the way. No big deal, you know.
Mm-hmm. Yes, but I still say Stevie is the man. Okay, gotta give it up.
I'm gonna transition into songwriting in a minute because Paul does have multiple songwriting credits. I want to do one more arrangement kind of concept here that also plays into the larger picture of what the vocals are doing, what everybody else is doing around the horns and strings and the kind of the sweetenings. I don't know what else to say there. So let's check this one out and make sure I got the right track here. Yeah. Drums. Now check out the vocals here. Call.
Make me blue with some other
dish. Call.
You before between the two of us, guys, you know I love you more. It took me by surprise.
So that song definitely has a lot of the conversational elements that we're talking about. Yes. Are there any other? So, Piranha Head, Maurice Hurd. Piranha is one of the. He was one of the first teachers here at Dime, along with me and Rayman and Antea. He is Grammy nominated with De La Soul as an arranger. Works with Al Sutton. Piranha's in the house here. Can we give him a round of applause, real quick? First and foremost, but Piranha is Paul's copyist. Or one of them. And so Paul will write these pieces out, and Piranha will then help, you know, visually get them ready for the session. And he gave me some enlightening tidbits about your work process. So am I correct that when you write parts, you are primarily sitting, maybe with the track as reference, maybe with the chord structure, but for the most part, you are sitting with a pen and sheet music?
That's right.
Yeah.
Never a piano. Yeah,
that's why we haven't touched this. I didn't think we would, but
I haven't touched a piano doing an arrangement about 50 years, literally. Yeah, because if you can't hear it, you can't write it.
So for those of you who roll your eyes when it's time to go to your theory and ear training classes here at Dime, and you have to learn your solfege and learn tonicism. Yeah. This is important stuff. So so when I ran into Paul upstairs and we're talking about some of the songs that he wrote, we were talking about them not in front of a piano, not with the recording, talking about the scale degrees, talking about what the choices were melodically, compositionally, just knowing the scale, right?
Yes.
So when are you thinking do, re, mi, 1, 2, 3, like what's your system for ear training?
Well, there's a center point, you know, the tonic. If you lose the tonic, you're through.
That's one. Tonic is one. Do.
All right. If you lose that, so it's about relative pitch, you know, as opposed to perfect pitch. I'd rather have the relative pitch as opposed to perfect. Perfect pitch will run you nuts, boy, I tell you. Literally, yeah. I think McKinley Jackson and Piranha both have the great arrangers who have a relative pitch. See, you find that reference, and you don't have to ever touch a keyboard or anything. Just keep hearing.
Can you talk about building tension with the melody, understanding where one is?
Texture and tension, and usually a song, a chord pattern will dictate certain things in music. But you have to understand classical music to really apply those things properly in the proper places. Because we're talking about textures and only 12 notes, but you have to use the proper textures in the proper places. You have to know when to use instruments in the upper range, mid range, low range, counter melodies, you know. So it's a lot of things within the use of these 12 notes, you know. Infinite combinations, you know. And that's what sets, I guess, arrangers apart, knowing how to place and when to place, what kind of textures to use, what kind of instruments to get as opposed to other instruments or within combinations with other instruments. And no two arrangers are ever alike. You can have 100 arrangers and give them the same demo to do, and you don't get 100 different ideas or concepts on that same exact demo, you know, because we think similar because we only have 12 notes to work with, like I said, but there are registers, there are textures, and infinite, you know, we have to work with. So that's what makes us unique, one to another, yeah.
Any more questions before I dive more into my own stuff here? Yes, yeah.
Hi, Mr. Reiser. My name's Allie. I work in the office, but I'm also a songwriter, and I actually have a young songwriter. She's like 14 years old that I'm just working with right now, and we've gotten to melody writing, and I realize it's sort of a difficult thing to teach and to talk about, and I wondered for you, when you're writing melodies, especially these call and responses, do they come out organically for you, or do you really think analytically about it? Like, oh, well, I really should start on the third here, and you know, it would really sound good if I did, you know, this particular thing, or is it more just you hum it to yourself and you just know that that's the right thing?
Well, some people have the gift of being able to pick melodies. Some people hear chords, some people hear the melodies and the chords, and I could take the same chord pattern and write maybe 10, 15, 20 melodies to it, see? Because you gotta, first of all, you have to kind of know intervals and passing tones, moving from one thing to another in a melody. You have to have, it's a gift, you know, to be able to do that. Now the only time I'll touch a piano is when I'm finding chords for composition, like with What Becomes of the Broken Hearted. I set up the chord patterns, didn't do any melody on that song, but the chord pattern, all the music I created. No melody, no lyrics, but I had partners who excelled at that, see? And therefore we came up with that song. We combined our talents, and that happened. That happens a lot. That happened a lot at Motown. You know, a producer or a writer may come up with just a chord, some chord patterns. McKinley can attest to this. Holland Dozier, Lamont Dozier, in that grouping would come, or Brian would come up with some chords. Then Eddie would come up with a melody, maybe, and some lyrics. Lamont would probably do all three, come up with chords, melody, and lyrics. But they worked in tandem like that. So that's a question I can't answer for anybody. It's just a gift that you have to do. You hear it, you don't hear it, you hear it and you change it. It's going to happen like that. You know, might change a melody or lyrics a dozen times in the same song.
How much?
Yeah.
as a springboard from that question, when it comes to melody writing, how much of it becomes vocabulary, where it's trial and error, and as you try new things, you see what works, and you build your kind of pocket of stuff that you can draw from. And the more stuff you have in your pocket, the more diverse it can become.
Yes. Well, you know, in R&B music, it's a matter of finding a chorus or a hook. And that hook really will allow you to develop the verse. It comes easy after you develop a catchy hook, you know. Now, in other genres of music, say classical and aria, it's just a matter of making all that melody work within the pure harmonics of a classical piece. But pop music, you know, you have so many variations that you can use. That's what the fun of it is. We break all the rules and come up with a hit. We're going to tell you.
Can we chime in? Is that okay?
Yeah.
So, Neil, can we get the wireless mic up front here for a minute? So
yes.
We have an unexpected guest in the house. I'm going to just be selfish. This is not about me, but I was fortunate to tour as the musical director for the Four Tops, the Motown group, for quite some time, and touring as the musical director for the Temptations was none other than Mr. McKinley Jackson. And he has he has arranged and conducted for the Temptations, for Tower of Power, for the Impressions. He was Marvin Gaye's musical director for many years. He was the go-to guy for Holland, Dozier, Holland. Holland, Dozier, Holland wrote all the hit songs for the Four Tops, Supreme, some for Marvin Gaye, et cetera, et cetera. And when they started their own label, McKinley was one of their go-to guys for arranging, and they still work with McKinley. And McKinley Jackson is here sitting in the front row. And I want, just since we're talking about writing melodies, McKinley writes awesome melodies as well.
Absolutely.
I want to hear your melodic composition input as well real quick.
Yeah.
McKinley Jackson, Absolutely. Everybody.
Absolutely. Oh, wow. Well...
Batman.
I'll tell you. Before I say anything, I just want to ask Paul a question.
Yes.
Isn't it true you got a Grammy for the Temptations on
Papa's
Rolling Stone?
Yeah.
Didn't you get a Grammy on that?
Yes.
And, you're beating us to it, Mac.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank
and,
you. Thank
and
you.
Isn't it true you also did "Wishing Upon a Star" from the Rolls Royce?
Yes.
Isn't it also true? Isn't it also true you
keep
did
it coming,
Billy
keep it
Preston,
coming. Yeah,
Nothing
don't,
for
don't,
Nothing?
Don't stop.
Nothing,
don't stop.
Nothing. Yes, yes.
Isn't it true you did
Billy
that
Preston,
also?
Yeah.
Isn't it true you also did Norman Connors and Phyllis Hyman and Gene Karn?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Neil, take this mic away from McKinley. No, I'm kidding. I'm kidding.
McKinley.
Luther Vandross, we know.
Oh,
never
yes.
too much, isn't it true you did that?
Yes.
Okay.
McKinley, let me tell you, McKinley Jackson is probably had a band or something to do with entertainment, 14, 15 in high school?
Also starting on trombone.
16.
And,
trombone.
Also starting on trombone, yeah.
Another trombone player, another broke down trombone player. But no, that is just a lot of trombone players do become arrangers. I think it's because of the ear training, because you have to hit so many precise positions, seven positions, you know.
Well, and the truth be told, I got to Motown as a trombonist because Paul called me.
Yeah.
To come in, because after he got busier and busier in the orchestration and arrangement, there was a vacancy, and there's a couple other guys, and I told him it was next door, and I went in and did the audition. No, but Paul and I. But as Paul was going to cast, I was going to Northern, but I was in the street, and I used to tell people. I left the streets to go to Motown. That's what kind of saved me. Motown was really a school, an institution within itself, and a factory, as Paul mentioned earlier. But
you know, our experiences are different, and I probably could have done a lot in the streets, but But cast egg for it.
So before this institution kicks me back out into the streets, melodic writing, McKinley, help us out. What are some of your tips for writing melodies?
Well, writing melodies. Well, you know, people, even songwriters, I have to not argue with them, but explain to them sometimes that a melody is superimposed upon chord structures. Mm-hmm. You can take a melody like in Misty, and if you change the chords, you have a different song, because so often they'll call an arranger and don't want to recognize the value of the contribution that you make to a composition.
Yeah.
Now, there's some things you just arrange, but other things, when they come in, and Paul said half-baked, when they come in half-baked, you sometimes, the point of it is, a melody has to be superimposed upon the chord structure. Mm-hmm. And basically, that's what happens. Even if you're writing a line, you still have to be
cognizant of the chord structure.
Chord structure. You're following that, and that kind of dictates your melody as much as you might hear a line, but it still has to, you know, follow the concords of the chords. So,
So, Allie, does that help with the math side of it, making sure that before you're writing the melodies, you understand what notes are inherent in the chords? Any other questions? Yes. Yeah. McKinley, isn't it true? No, I'm just kidding.
No, go ahead.
No. MacMahon.
Hi, I'm Eldred. And as an educator, you open up with it at the beginning about talking about the importance of relationships. And if I recall correctly, early on in your career, an artist came in and had a tune and used an arrangement of it, and they were not happy. So they told Barry, you know, get something else. And Barry pulled you aside and said, Paul, you go home, work on this a little bit and bring it back now.
Oh, yeah.
Which you did. Obviously, the relationship that you had established helped him to have the confidence in you. And
yes.
That's great. And I'm grateful.
Well, a quick story. Early in my career, you know, it's probably just beginning to do strings. And I got a hold of a song that Berry Gordy produced. I forget the artist. I forget the name of the song. But it was like a sort of a Burt Bacharach type, you know, very, very complex and the chord structure and everything. And there's such a thing as accidentals. The musicians in the room here understand accidentals, right?
And naturals.
Yes. See, what happens if you have a complex song like that, a lot of compound chord patterns and whatnot, and it might modulate within the verse two or three times. You have to change accidentals, you know, from one key to another. I missed everything with Berry Gordy's production. Okay. So Holland Doja Holland, you know, whom had a lot of influence in. They were tearing up the charts with hits. We're talking about the mid-60s, somewhere in there. So they said, Barry, you need to let that guy go, because he ain't gonna make it, man. He's messing up your music. So Barry, being the person he is, he always believed in talent. He knew... He had vision all the time. He understood talent. You could spot it a mile off. And he was one of my biggest supporters back then, unbeknownst to me. So he told me, young man, just take it home and bring it back tomorrow. And brought it back with all the right notes, and the rest was history. You know, otherwise, he might have sent me out to pasture, you know. But Barry is one of my greatest supporters, you know, because of that, yeah. But Holland Doja the Holland, we laugh about it now. Oh, we laugh big time. Because, that was a pivotal point in my career, literally. Yeah.
So I want to bring up a melody that we were talking about earlier today. This is the concertmaster for the Detroit Symphony Orchestra was Gordon Staples.
Yes.
And he was also doing a lot of the actual session work for Motown as well.
Yes.
And so Motown allowed him to have his name out front in a solo album, which was Gordon Staples and the String Thing.
Right.
And doing almost all of the composition, in addition to all of the arranging and production on this album, was Mr. Paul Reiser. And so this is a Paul Reiser original tune that was released with Gordon Staples' name out front called Strung Out. And singers in the room real quick, I'm not one. So I'm going to ask you guys to help me out. Who's the singer? Help me out. Okay, cool. Ivante, can I get you to come up for a second? This is Ivante Corbin, everybody. He's one of our vocal students here at DIME.
Yes.
So I'm going to play this song, and it's going to be a bit awkward. I'm just going to ask Tay to stay up here and listen for a second, and we're going to find the tonic together. We're going to find one, and we're going to hum the tonic, and we're going to pay attention to where this melody ends in relation to the tonic, and we're going to talk about what effect it has, all right?
Mm-hmm.
So here we go. This is Strung Out from Gordon Staples' String Thing. Yep. Paul Reiser composition. Oh, it's okay. There we go. We found our tonic. Can everybody sing it with us? Listen to this one note.
Dominant seven. Yeah.
So what's the tonic?
Yeah. That's it?
And the melody ends on what note? Yes.
Yeah, that's
Ivante Corbin, everybody.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So tell us about that landing note and why you notice it's not the tonic. It's not ending on the tonic.
Mm-hmm.
So what's going on there?
Well, that's what they call a blue note, okay? That's the blue note, the heavy, you know, very heavy. Our dominant seven. You know, it adds a little funky tone to your melody. Okay, so it was a natural. It didn't take a lot of thought for me to come up with that. You know,
no big deal.
yeah.
So what I love about that melody,
yes,
is that because it ends on the dominant seventh, and it's I'm getting super nerdy here, and it's the dominant seventh in an ascending melody. You want it so badly to keep going up, and it's one step away in the scale, one step away from resolving to the tonic, but it doesn't. And because it doesn't, it creates tension. It makes it sound almost like dangerous. Like,
you want it to
go right back up to the tonic, but it won't. Let's listen to it one more time without hearing the tonic and see if you catch what I'm talking about, where when that melody ends, your ear wants it to keep going, and Paul's like, Paul says no. Tonic right there. That is the tonic. That came easy to him. He's bragging now.
that's that motif factor that you talked about.
Yes, repeating that idea of it, the motif repeating throughout the song. Mm-hmm. Now, the very next track on this album, melodically, this is very different. And even beyond the idea that one is a minor key or using a blues scale versus the other using a more diatonic major scale, mm-hmm. let's listen to how this melody resolves and where it resolves and see how it makes us feel in comparison. This is Toonie off the same record.
That's Dennis Coffey playing sitar.
So in that case, our tonic is da,
that's it.
Right? Mm-hmm. And notice, this is, I'm going to get nerdy here on you guys, da, so do, re, re, mi, starts on re, I can't sing. But I got relative pitch, but I can't sing.
Do, re, mi.
So it starts on do, re, re, right? Yeah. Re, mi, mm-hmm. fa, mi, then jumps up to la, jumps da, up to the six.
The six.
Up to the six,
right,
yep.
Right.
Ending on the one, and then even when it jumps up the register, it comes back to the one each time to land on that tonic. Yes. So it feels like it's resolving more because your melody is centering around and landing on the tonic. One more time. Sorry, guys. I'm geeking out. Still ending on the tonic there. Yep. Yeah. Right. Yeah. So any questions for Paul about melodic writing? Anything else? I'm sorry we got super geeky there, but DIME students, learn your theory, because then you can geek out with me and Paul. any questions about melodic writing up here? No? You must be doing real good.
Now, everybody knows what comes of the brokenhearted, right? Now, you know what's unique about that song, which probably a lot of people don't know, musicians know. It never lands on the tiny. Yep. Never.
Let's listen to that real quick. This is a song that Paul co-wrote. He wrote the chords.
Yes, all the music, yeah.
And Jimmy Witherspoon.
William Witherspoon. James Dean. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Here we go.
That's the tonic.
So it sets the tonic up there, but then it... And a whole key modulation right here.
Oh.
What's fascinating about that song, no bridge. No bridge to that song. Just A section, B section.
Never resolves.
Yep. Yep, never resolves. And this song, I had to look it up myself, because this song that Paul co-wrote not only was a hit that we just heard by Jimmy Ruffin, but it was also covered by Diana Ross and the Supremes, Chris Farlow, Baby Washington, Dave Stewart, Boy George, Ruby Turner, Wild Romance, Robinson and Jerome, Vonda Shepherd, Joan Osborne, Rod Stewart, Ian Moss, Martina McBride, yeah. The Irish boy band Westlife in the 2000s, Jimmy Barnes, as well as Air Supply.
Yeah.
Yes, yeah. So this one song has been covered by so many artists.
Yes.
Can we talk about another one that's been covered by the Rolling Stones, by the Jackson 5, Michael Jackson? Can we talk about Don't Know Why by Stevie Wonder?
Yes.
So tell us about, the reason I want to bring this up is because there is a very thin line between arrangement and songwriting and being a part of the composition team that sees royalties as a songwriter, getting into the business side of things. So,
Let me explain my my relationship with Stevie in as far as that. He gave me quite a few writing credits, but it was because he appreciated the arranging I did for him. See, Stevie doesn't need a co-writer, right? He's a genius all in himself. So, but he appreciated so much what I did for him that he gave me writer's credits. So sometimes that happens. Oh, yes.
So
yes.
We're getting into the business side of things here.
Yes. Yes. Now, I did 6x6 on Earl Van Dyke, and that was pretty decent hit. But, that's it. What it does is, it sometimes takes a good business sense to really know how to deal with percentages and things like that. It was very early in my career where I didn't understand that. So with this song here, a particular engineer received writing credits unbeknownst to me. I found out once the song was out, okay? Sometimes it happens that way. You know, if you don't really understand the business, it can happen that way. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So there was a interview where you were talking about the kind of business progression from being a session freelance musician, just playing on the tracks. Mm-hmm. Can you talk about the development of that throughout your career?
Yeah. Well, in junior high school, I was doing transcriptions. So jazz transcriptions, and then I would take them to a band rehearsal with me. It's a Parks Recreation Boys Band. And that's where I developed my ear, see, because as an arranger, you got to have a good ear, see, a good solid ear to be able to understand harmonies and chordal structures and whatnot. So I learned in junior high school to transcribe. So once I got to Cass Tech, I learned the theory of music, which was very important, of course. You know, that's your scales and touch of chords and the math of music. You know, music is nothing but mathematics when you really break it down. So I learned that, and then once I got a call to Motown, I was pretty much ready to as a trombone player, I came in, but I was ready to write music, but not at the level that I needed to make it in Motown. So after a year or two, after copying other arranger scores, Johnny Allen, Maurice King, Ernie Wilkins, different people like that, Slide Hampton, Wade Marcus, you know, great arrangers. I was able to really see what it took to orchestrate and lay things out on the paper properly. So then I transitioned from being a trombonist, which I've considered to be a full-time job playing trombone. But orchestration also and arranging is full-time, if you want to break it down. If you're going to play the instrument, you want to be a perfectionist. I'm a perfectionist. See? So I had to make a decision. So I gave up the trombone playing in lieu of orchestration and arranging and composing.
Tell me about the session rates when you first started. How much they were?
How about $2.50, no time limits, okay?
Per song, right?
Per song, $2.50 per song. Nowadays, this is when Berry Gordy was making hits in the beginning. It was a new experience for all of us. Then we got a raise, $5, right? Then we got another raise, $7.50 a song. Then we got another raise up to $15, and then somehow the union came in, and the rest was history after that. But, I don't know, does everybody understand the term signatory? A record company signatory, that means that you are registered with the Federation, the national and international union, as a signatory, meaning that you sign up to abide by all the rules of the union so that the musicians can get paid, pension, health and welfare, all those things, you pay. But Motown, they wouldn't let Motown become a signatory for years, see? And then, so Berry just went on like a maverick, you know, and just went on. But finally, they let him in. And they didn't think he was going to make it. You know, the major record companies didn't think he was going to make it. They let him kind of slip through the cracks.
Because Motown was indie before indie was indie. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And how about as an arranger? Do you negotiate work for higher prices as one-off sessions? Do you do royalty deals, or does it just depend on the project?
Well, first of all, union scale is not what everybody should charge. It's the least you can charge. The sky's the limit, actually, you know. Mm-hmm. So you have to know what your own worth is and charge accordingly, you know.
Yeah. How do you, because today you have managed to maintain being current with all of these new artists that we've been talking about who are having hits right now, Mary J. Blige and Raphael Saadiq and he who we'll have to edit out. So how do you go about prioritizing and saying yes versus no to opportunities that come your way?
Well, it's just that certain producers, usually those are ones who call, and every once in a while an artist will call, but it's usually a producer. Mm-hmm. And if they've got credibility in the industry, and they have integrity, you know, as far as paying, because some do, some don't. You know, we kind of judge according to that, and we kind of have an idea of the material. They'll usually send out 2, 3, 4, 5 songs, whatever the project is, and make a decision, you know.
Does anybody have any questions about the business side, the of arranging session work, recording? No? All right, I guess we're doing real good today then. okay, I want to go back and do one more kind of arranging and production example here, because we were talking about knowing the chords and building your melodies off the chords, but sometimes you end up with a song that does not have a particularly difficult chord progression, or it's an unchanging chord progression.
Rolling Stone. How did you know?
And so Norman Whitfield and Barrett Strong were a songwriting production team at Motown that were responsible for tons of hits on The Temptations, Undisputed Truth, Marvin Gaye, and this is one of the songs that garnered Mr. Reiser a Grammy, but I have broken it down to as close as I can get to the string part here, and I just want you guys to listen to this arrangement and listen to the vocabulary that's being used both melodically, harmonically, as well as just the sounds of the instruments, because you can get so many different sounds out of one instrument, all over a very repetitive chord structure.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Yes. Challenging. Thank you. Maurice Davis. Maurice Davis, trumpet.
Not a single chord change. This song was like 15 minutes or something crazy like that.
Yes. 17.
17 minutes. You can hear the two guitars of that conversation as well, yeah? Mm-hmm. How many chord changes have there been? None. So how many people in here produce their own music, produce their own beats, whether it's FL Studio or whatever it may be? I know we got quite a few, Najee. Yep. So this is in some ways like an early loop because you're dealing with limited harmonic information. It's the same motif, ba-da-ba-da-ba-bum, all day long. How do you keep it fresh? How do you keep those ideas coming when you don't have the math of the chords to work with?
Section it off and try to work one section against the other. Different parts, different instruments, talking to one another. And textures. Yeah, I'm sorry. Textures and just play with things, you know, and try to make it interesting, and hope for a bridge at some point, which never came.
Yes. Producers, oh, give man. Them a bridge, please.
Yeah. It's a challenge, though, you know. It really is.
And so in that same kind of wheelhouse, how have you found ways to keep current in the changing musical genres throughout the decades? Because we've spent so much time on Motown, but Paul's been arranging hit songs in the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, the 90s, the 2000s, the 2010s. So how do you stay true to yourself while changing?
How do you stay fresh?
Yeah.
Bad memory. Okay. Or believe me, with just 12 notes, it's easy to repeat yourself, I tell you, at some point. You know, because, I mean, you just have so many chord patterns to work with. You know, they repeat themselves after a while. And you just have to just get some sleep and stay fresh. Yeah. It's really difficult, though, you know. But if you think about it, you'll repeat yourself. See, don't think about it. Just do it, you know. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Any more questions about anything here for Paul?
Yeah. I have a question.
Yeah, Neil. Yes.
So, I was speaking with Kevin earlier, and he was talking about Signed, Sealed, and Delivered by Stevie Wonder, and how iconic that horn arrangement is. And I know that Kevin wanted to see a little bit of a breakdown of that, but yeah, I mean, if you guys could.
Yeah, so I happen to have that one queued up as well. So this is Signed, Sealed, Delivered by Stevie Wonder, which Paul did arrange, yeah. Yeah, and this is just some of it. So you guys hear that there it sounds like a guitar that's droning on the tonic.
Electric sitar.
It is electric sitar, and sitar is an Indian, am I right? Indian instrument?
It's East India.
East India, mm-hmm. Yeah. And so in the 60s, you had the Beatles and everybody starting to use world instruments, yeah. And this company came up with an electric sitar.
Right.
So that is electric sitar in this song.
That's Dennis Coffey, yeah.
The other thing about this song is, once again, listen to just the drums and raise your hand, audience, do me a favor, raise your hand every time you hear a drum fill. Raise your hand when you hear the drums fill. Yep. That's just one side. I've split this track from left and right. So that's one drum part. Here's the second. You'll hear the echo of the drum part because they played live together.
Right.
So you'll hear a little ghost of that first drum part, but check out the fills this time. So what I'm getting at here is there are no fills.
Yeah.
So you had one drummer who's just playing the groove, not changing at all, which gives it this feel.
And guess what? Do you hear Stevie in there playing drums? You can feel it. He's in there. Yeah. Nobody plays like him.
I bet.
Okay.
The pickup drummer is Stevie.
Yeah.
I bet.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk about that horn motif.
Oh yeah.
Yes. So let's listen to the horns, both that iconic motif as well as in the chorus, and hear how they fit into the picture. Barry saxophone.
Mike Terry.
So that's that motif that we're talking about, yep. So for that motif, that iconic, was that in the recording before you heard it?
That's the demo.
That was in there.
Oh, Stevie. There's Stevie's. Yeah.
And so, but the motif that is all yours is what we pointed out in the chorus. Right. And is it coincidence that that's drawing from the same scale as the walk down? Da, 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 da. Right. It's just going.
It's automatic, almost, you know?
Yeah.
Kind of counter. It's a little counter move.
And call and response with his vocals and horns, would you say?
Yeah.
So he's saying yes, call and response between vocals and that horn motif as well, filling in the space. Yeah, let's listen to that one more time. Stevie, horns. So that song, the motif is simple, and it repeats, but it fills those gaps of where the vocals are versus the horns.
Yes.
Do we have any more questions before I want to? Yes. Yeah.
Question over here to your right. To your right. First of all,
over here.
Mr. Riser, thanks for being here this afternoon. Hi, Drew. This is Mike. My question for you is, so when you get a demo and it's just really simple, just say piano and vocals, and you start building on it, start adding layers of horns, layers of strings, do you ever get to a point where you've got too much and then you take a couple layers out for the finished product, or do you keep it all, do you keep adding and adding and adding?
Wow. Well, first of all, we start with the foundation of rhythm, okay? The demos usually come in piano and voice. So we hear certain elements in there for building the rhythm section, even if it's just piano and voice. McKinley can attest to that in the Piranha. It dictates certain things, you know, if it's a good piano demo, you know, and you just, you hear things on top of that naturally. And Valerie Simpson does great piano demos also.
Where do you stop? Where do you say that's enough stuff?
When they run out of money.
Best answer all day.
No. No, seriously though. It's a matter of taste. You know, you have to know. Just have to know. And sometimes it may not necessarily mean taking something out, but just maybe moving it to another instrument. It's every song is like a fingerprint, you know? Yeah.
I know what your question in the back on this side of the room, Piranha specifically pointed it out. Can we jump over there? Thanks, Cass. Cool.
Where you?
Oh, man, Mr. Holland is here.
Hello.
All my heroes are in the house today. Yeah.
Now where are you?
I'm right here, right in front of you.
Okay.
My name's JB. I'm a songwriter here. Mm-hmm. So I was just kind of wondering if you could give us some insight into how your process has changed or evolved over the years. Like, are there things that you find yourself still doing that you used to do? Are there things that you know now that you wish you did back then? What are some of those things?
You grow. You know, But certain things remain distinct to each arranger. Okay, certain things have worked over the 50 some odd years. Why change it, right? Certain techniques and whatnot. Of course, now we grow psychologically, we grow musically, and so therefore we add as we go. You know, we experiment sometimes, you know. Within a safety realm, though, we experiment. You know, you have to try new things here and there. And then, of course, you listen to other arrangers, other materials in the marketplace, and we all live and learn. Classics really teach you well.
On the way in, we were playing some of an album that I don't want to name now, and yeah. You were listening back to it, and it was something you had done. You're like, man, that sounds rough now. Like,
oh, yes.
So what about that sounds rough in hindsight that you would change?
Let's see. See, being a perfectionist and using live musicians, you're not going to get perfection. See, point blank. Now, if you're using synthesizers and whatnot, you could look for perfection, which then you lose some character in the performances and the songs. So I'd rather use live musicians and have their imperfections, you know? Seriously.
And then I actually had another quick question. Mm-hmm. So I read online that in an interview you said your favorite arrangement was Diana Ross's cover of Ain't No Mountain High Enough. So I thought that was interesting, and what were some of the things you liked about that arrangement?
Well, just because it's classically oriented and classically based. I loved the piano rendering she did, Valerie. She played that one. The way it changed colors here and there, changed moods. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
I think we got time for one more question. Yes. Yeah. Yeah. By the way, I definitely encourage you all to look up Mr. Reiser on discogs.com, like discography. It's a just jaw-dropping list, and there are so many beautiful songs and arrangements to check out. Yeah.
Hi, my name is Tara Porter.
And where are you?
I'm right here. Over here.
Okay.
Hi.
That's you.
My name is Tara Porter.
Okay.
Stage name is Luna. Okay. I'm a vocalist here, freshman. And I just wanted to know, a lot of the songs that you guys created back in those days, were they mostly inspired by what was going on in that era, or were they like personal, or were they just created? Were they like imagination?
All the above.
Okay. You know?
And well, first of all, Berry Gordy, when he started Motown, see, he's a song person. If you haven't got a good song, get out of his space. You know, I'm serious. Yeah. He could smell a hit record, but what would happen is that say if a producer or a writer had a good track, but they had a mediocre melody or a vocal on top, he might take it off and assign it to another person, another artist, or another writer. You see, to get the most out of it. And we just had that kind of procedure at Motown, you know? Yeah.
Cool. I want to take us out for these last couple minutes with just strings and vocals on one of those arrangements that to me is amazing. And I'll let you guys figure out what it is here.
Ooh, baby. Ain't nothing like the real thing, baby. Ain't nothing like the real thing.
No, no.
Ain't nothing like the real thing, baby. Ain't nothing like the real thing.
No, honey.
I've got your picture.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Paul Reiser.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Now, Paul is one of our artists in residence this year, so you will be seeing more of Mr. Reiser.
Yes,
one more time,
you.
Paul Reiser.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Jim.
Man, are you kidding
me? My man. Yes. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.